Arunachala Shiva, Arunachala. Arunachala Shiva, Arunachala Shiva, Arunachala. Arunachala Mena Agame Vinay Pavala Gattai Veva Rupai Arunachala. Tam Purira Kadiras Tam Vaitamudavane Tira Harumadiya Machala Sirayari Tunivana Mashidar Sirayari Tarulana Chala Suga Kadatunga Sunduna Vardanga Summa Karmachala Sudhu Seyennai Soriyadiniyun Jodhi Guru Kakarnachala Seppadi Vittai Gattri Padi Mayakku Vitturu Padu Vittai Kakarnachala
Arunachala
Vedam Korula Rula Machala. சிலந்தி போல் கட்டி சிறையில் குண்டனை அருணாச்சலா.
அன்போடு நாமங்கள் அன்பதம் அன்ப கண்பனாச்சலா.
என் போலும் தேவரை இங்குற காத்து நீ என் நாடும் வாழ்ந்தருள் அருணாச்சலா.
Should practice meditation on gross objects only. It may be disastrous if one constantly seeks to kill the mind. Maharshi, for whom is it disastrous? Can there be disaster apart from the self? Unbroken I is the ocean infinite. The ego, I thought, remains only a bubble on it and is called jiva, that is individual soul. The bubble too is water. When it bursts, it only mixes in the ocean. When it remains a bubble, it is still a part of the ocean. Ignorant of this simple truth, innumerable methods under different denominations such as yoga, bhakti, karma, etc., each again with many modifications, are being taught with great skill and in intricate detail only to entice the seekers and confuse their minds. So also are the religions and sects and dogmas. What are they all for? Only for knowing the self. There are aids and practices required for knowing the self. Objects perceived by the senses are spoken of as immediate knowledge. Pratyaksha. Can anything be as direct as the self? Always experienced without the aid of the senses. Sense perceptions can only be indirect knowledge and not direct knowledge. Only one's own awareness is direct knowledge, as is the common experience of one and all. No aids are needed to know one's own self, that is to be aware. The one infinite unbroken whole plenum becomes aware of itself as I. This is its original name. All the other names, example Om, are later growths. Liberation is only to remain aware of the self. The Mahavakya, I am Brahman, is its authority. Though the I is always experienced, yet one's attention has to be drawn to it. Only then does knowledge dawn. Thus, the need for instruction of the Upanishads and of wise sages. Hari Om.
Sadguru Rayane, Ramana Sadguru Rayane, Ramana Sadguru Rayane.
Sadguru Ramana Sadguru Rayane
Amana Jnana Karutpelungagal Arumayan Giri Tannile Vimalame Uru Vagi Vandoru Virupana Anjali Tilo
Sadguru, Ramana Sadguru, Ramana Sadguru, Rayane. Ramana Sadguru, Ramana Sadguru, Ramana Sadguru.
Yeah, Guru Ramana.
Ramana Sadguru, Ramana Sadguru Rayane. Ramana Sadguru, Ramana Sadguru, Ramana Sadguru Rayane.
Sadguna Kadalana Natuna Sajjana Kudanidhiya Arkuda Shubayana Parina Asimana Kuruvanavan
Bhakti Yor Panindin Vridu Vatta Kodiya Kangalai Ramana Sadguru Rayane Ramana Sadguru Ramana Sadguru Ramana Sadguru Rayane Ramana Sadguru Ramana Sadguru Ramana Sadguru Rayane Ramana Sadguru Ramana
Sadguru Ramana
vindati haji vastu daivikaha ahamapetakam nijavibhanakam mahadidam tapo ramanavagiyam.
Ramanaya.
Ramanaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Sri 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 Ramanaya.
Om Shanti
Shanti Shanti.
No.
Why are you doing?
Gurur Brahma, Gurur Vishnu, Gurur Devo Maheshwaraha, Guru Sakshat Param Brahma, Tasmai Shri Gurave Nama, Tasmai Shri Gurave Nama, Tasmai Shri Gurave Nama. बोलो रमण भगवान की जय। रमण महर्षि इज वन ऑफ द सेंट्स अमंग मेनी सेंट्स हु रियलाइज द ट्रूथ विदाउट स्टडिंग स्क्रिप्चर्स। ही स्टडीड स्क्रिप्चर्स व्हेन आफ्टर रियलाइज। And what are we doing? We are cramming our head with all the scriptures in order to realize the truth which is beyond the scriptures. Isn't it? Yes, we do need the grace of the Lord. We do need the grace of the Mahatmas, realized masters. But mere remembrance of theirs in our heart is enough. Does that mean, what are you saying, that we should stop studying the scriptures? No, please study. Continue doing that. That is what has brought us to Mahatmas like Bhagavan Ramana Maharishi. That's what has brought Mahatmas in our midst, who come by of their own accord and give us the blessings, who give us satsang, who teach us the scriptures, isn't it? It's not because of our will that we have brought the Mahatmas into our life. See? So if Ramana Maharishi, Bhagavan Ramana Maharishi, what did he do? Immediately the question comes. If he did not study scriptures, then what did he do? The scriptures say, na karmana na prajanane na. He did not do anything. By doing Karmana, self cannot be realized. Prajaya, it cannot be realized. By wealth, it cannot be realized. Then how did he realize? How did he realize? His attention throughout his life was only on that throb, only on that continuous throb of I. Because of whom seeing, hearing, touching, feeling, thinking, experiencing, knowing is going on. What is that? And how did that strike him? That he must seek that. How did it strike him? Because when he saw one day that there is a dead person going out of from his window, he saw he was, I think, 13, 14 years old, isn't he? And he, immediately after seeing that dead body, he played dead on his bed. And that very moment, within few minutes, he experienced an out-of-body experience. And he came to know at that age that he is not the body. Only once you need to have that experience. He invoked that experience by playing dead. For some people it comes across as an accident. Suddenly in that moment of accident something happens. Sometimes there is a deep loss of someone dear. Then it happens. Deep depression also can bring that about. A great joy can also bring that about. How it manifests, that's not your concern. But for that, you have to live life to the fullest. Then it will happen. And to him it happened as an out-of-body experience. And once he had that, now the question, he wasn't, by God's grace that thought appeared in it, that then, if I am not the body, then who was looking at this body which was lying there on the bed? I don't know, as kids, whether, did you experience that? Did you ever go through that? Did these type of thoughts come in your mind? Did you wonder, how big is this space? Did you wonder who is seeing? Every child, because interact with children, yes, who is functioning behind our eyes, Swamiji? They know that there is someone. You also, but as we grow old, as we grow so-called wise, we forget those innocent remarks. As a child, you are watching everything as a third person. You are seeing, you see the latest series called Hanuman. Bajrang, what is that? Sankat Mochan Mahavali Hanuman. In that, Hanumanji is continuously speaking in third person about himself. Maruti. Maruti ko abhiye chahiye, Maruti ko abho chahiye. Now Maruti is hungry, now Maruti wants milk. Mummy, can Maruti go to play? Everything in third person. And that is the age when they speak. You also spoke. Because you saw that you are not the body. It is a natural disposition of everyone. Then what happened? Then what happened to all of us? Where did we make the wrong turn in our life? No, Swamiji, we didn't make any wrong turn. It happened. We were sent to school. We were given slaps. Say, I want to, mummy, can I go to school? To play outside. I am hungry. Don't say Maruti is hungry. This is what you remember your days, or if some kids are around, you see when they are two and a half, three, this is all parents start changing their language. And then it goes deeper and deeper, this I am this, I am seeing, I am hearing, I am touching, feeling, I am hungry, I am sleepy, I have to study, I have to survive, I have to educate. And then after you wake up, go through 20, 30 years of this journey of strengthening the I, by mistake you come to a satsang like this. And what do you start? How to delete the I? Again, 30 years go to delete the I, to find out that originally you were okay. See, this is the joy of life. But some amongst us, some Mahatmas, let it be Satya Sai Baba, Ammachi, Ramana Maharishi and so on, they all caught the bull by his horn and they rode him. They didn't allow him to trample him. They rode him. And they came to realize that there is no journey involved between me and myself. There is no journey involved. The journey only seems to be a seeming journey when something called this mind comes in between. And they were also having the mind. Baba was also having the mind. Shirdi Sai Baba also was having the mind. Ramana Maharishi was also having the mind. But they did not complain about that mind. And what do? We find every damn reason in this world to show that How can I think about this I? The world is not allowing me to contemplate on I. The hunger is not allowing me to contemplate on I. The responsibility is not allowing me to contemplate on the I. When I sit down on the I, the mind comes in between. And we keep complaining and complaining and complaining and complaining. Isn't it? Why? We have become complaint boxes. That's all. Because we are giving more importance to the mind than to the conscious self. That is why. Why God doesn't come to us, even if we do so much puja and everything? If you see this photograph, we have chanted so many times, so many mantras just now. What was going on in your mind? What was going on in your mind? Was it a mechanical chanting? Or were you seeing Ramana Maharishi sitting in front of you and you were offering the various incantations to him as a remembrance, as an offering to him? Or there is no picture, there is absolute silence and you are doing all the chantings with awareness? Which one was it? Or was it a very turbulent mind thinking, I have to do this, after this I'll do that, I'll do this, and mind is, the mouth is automatically going on, kar 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 kar. Which one? See? Even though Ramana Maharishi says, contemplate on who am I, why would he write such a beautiful poem on Arunachala? Why would he write? Because he sees that Arunachala also not other than the self. And we keep complaining about everything other than the self. We make it into a problem which needs to be dealt with. In this world there is nothing to be dealt with. There is nothing a problem. Absolutely not a problem. You make it a problem by defining it as a problem. And if you keep thinking about the world and keep asking questions, but how do I remove the mind, but how do I remove body identification, but how do I do the pranayama, how do I do it, pranabandhana liyate manaha, or whatever the mantra comes in Upadeshar, which is similar. How do I do it? How do I do it? Are yaar, try to karo. Pehle, first questions. How? Why? I want to understand. What is there to understand that you are alive? Why you need to understand? Why do you need to understand? Does the child start learning to walk after understanding? Does a child learn to speak after understanding how to speak? Or he just puts his best effort that is available at that moment, isn't it? And one day suddenly, yesterday I was with some kid, not yesterday, day before yesterday, only 3.5 month old, and he has discovered that he can make sound. And he is sitting on my thing, and we are in a restaurant, and some people are at the back, and he's looking, going on, and he's enjoying his own sound. You remember, you see the small kid, they enjoy their sound, that's why they are doing it continuously. And we say, what is this silly thing you are doing? He's enjoying it. He has discovered. One child was there, she did not know. She will say, road, load. Laptop, run, learn. So she is Chinese. Well, Indian, but speaking like a Chinese. No R. Then I used to feed her. After every Bhagavat class, I used to sit down, I used to feed her. And one day, I said, okay, now you do drrr, l. But she did not give up. For a few months, the parents used to pick me up, bring to the Bhagavat class. And one day, they discovered, because every time they pick me up, I am doing this exercise with her. One day, on a weekend, she stood in front of the mirror and she's saying, where is she going wrong? And suddenly, in that effort, it became effortless for her to, the first time, the r came. And his father, I said, don't tell me, let her tell me herself. Then that Saturday she came, Swamiji, in the ears, I want to tell you something. What? Paramananda. She spoke my name. Paramananda. You see, how much joy, this simple, silly thing, but how much joy. Even her effort was not an effort. Because she didn't think it was an effort. It was a joyful exploration of herself, isn't it? And what are we doing? A miserable exploration of ourselves. My God, we have to realize, Nahi Swamiji, it is not possible in this life. It may be for Mahatmas, but we are papis, we are guilty, we are desirous. It is not possible. If you interact like this, say that joyfully at least. Isn't it? Then there may be a door opens up. Look at that child, how joyfully it keeps exploring herself or himself. That joyfully, that, what do you call, continuously, with that concentration, which is natural. It is not that they are thinking hard, but it's a natural disposition. You seek yourself. You be yourself. But joyfully. It is not going to come by following what Ramana Maharishi did. It is not going to come by following what other Mahatmas did. It will only happen by you discovering your own way to yourself. Scriptures give you a guideline. Mahatmas give you what he did, he has given you a guideline. But how it will unfold inside of you, you don't know. To expect that it will happen the way it happened to him, forget it. That I will sit with my eyes open for 3 days. You will be frustrated. You will be frustrated. So don't copy anyone. It has to be a unique unfoldment within you, because each one of us is different, and that unique way you have to find out. Teachings can be the same, but how it unfolds, how you find a passage through yourself to yourself, because what difficulties came to him will not come to you. You are a different product altogether, born at a different time to a different parent with a different samskaras. Yeah, in a different region, even kids of the same parent, maybe twins, they may look alike, but still there will be their own idiosyncrasies. See, so you have to find your way to yourself. And really speaking, there is no way. What will be the distance covered by a wave to reach the water? Nothing. A wave is nothing but water. But it says, I want to realize the infinite waters. Hey, you are the water. No. It cannot be that easy. It cannot be that easy. There must be. If it was that easy, then everyone would have realized by now. No. Tell me something more. Something wise. Don't take me for a ride, Swamiji. Please don't tell me. Tell me. No, you are the water. But what do I have to do? But I'm not catching it. I'm not being it. I think I have to do something. Na karmana. Nahi, aise mat bolo yaar. Kuch to bolo. That I have to do. Na karmana is not enough. Don't say like that. I'm getting confused. Tell me something. Then when something like this, such type of a student comes, then what our Ramana Maharishi has said? What is that verse? Is it in this one? Prana bandhanat leena manasam. Eka chindanat. Nashametyadaha. The very mind that has subsided through restraint of breath. The same thought comes in our panchadashi. It says prana bandhanat liyate mana. Your leena manasam, that in the pranas merge your mind. Where do you merge the mind in the pranas? Because who is it told to? It is told to that student who is not ready to accept that he is of the nature of reality at this very moment. That wave which does not want to accept that it is water. You can see how foolish it is. If that wave says, no, I am not, I have to do something. Similarly, Guru Maharaj also laughs at us. But wo dikhate nahi hai humne. That he doesn't show it on the face, but he's laughing away from inside. What man, such type of students come to me, or such devotees come. Scriptures are screaming away, I am screaming away, how much I have to tell? So, prana bandhanat liyate manaha. Prana bandhanat is what, where the breath begins or where the breath ends. Or where the breath ends and the next breath is about to begin, that sandhi, liyate manaha or lina manasam. You merge your mind into it. Why has he taken that? Why has not taken any mantra or something like that? Why? Because breath is inert. It does not have any likes and dislikes. It is a natural phenomena which is going on from the moment of birth to the death. It doesn't say, oh, I'm tired now. Oh, I think I should stop breathing. It goes on incessantly, whether you want or you don't want, it doesn't ask your permission. And it has got one more job. What is that? It keeps the mind and the body stuck together. It is like a glue, when you put a stamp on an envelope, how do? So that glue is the breath, which is sticking the body on the mind. Mind is much master, it's subtler. Anything that is subtle is larger and more pervading than the gross. So body is gross, it is like a stamp, and the mind is like the envelope, larger than the body. On that, this body is stuck. Now, if you want to reuse the body, if you want to reuse the stamp, very carefully you will separate it, isn't it? If you just pull it out, you will tear the stamp. Because post office walon ne stamp nahi lagaya, chalo use kar lete hain. India mein to aise karte the. So take it out. But what do you do to take it out so that there is no damage to the stamp? You will put it in water. Automatically it separates out. Exactly the same way. When your attention, your mind is merged into that sandhi, prana bandhanat, between the two breaths, you put your mind single pointedly in a relaxed manner, not in a, oh, how to put that on. No, very, very relaxed. Very, very naturally. Then this stamp leaves the mind. The stamp of the body leaves, separates from the mind very naturally, without any karkash, without any friction, without any tearing, without any, without any repentance. See? But when it is done forcefully, if someone is trying to wake you up, hey, yellow, get up, you have to go to school. Oh, five more minutes. Why? Body is still attached to no mind. That's why it's not wanting to go. It's enjoying the bliss. And to pull you out, eventually that child gets angry, but parents are used to it. He gets angry every day. It doesn't matter. But exactly the same thing, just like that child complains about getting up, so also the mind and body, when they are separating, if it is not done in a smooth, elegant, natural way, then the mind will scream. It will feel the loss of the body. It doesn't want to, because all its eggs are in one basket, and that basket is called the body. It sees, hears, touches, feels, tastes, experiences, knows, communicates everything through the body. And if the body is not there, it goes into fear cycle. Fear. Oh, how will I survive? How will I do? How will I... do I exist without the body? How will I exist? But when it happens, and you do that naturally every night when you go to sleep, anyway. But when on the seat of meditation this is brought about, if it is not, if it is done through force, if it is done through forcible, you know, like some Kundalini followers, they invoke the Kundalini by hitting it on the coccyx again and again and again and again. They are also pranabandhana. There also you breathe out and then you force the energy or feel the energy to move up your spine. But it is unnatural there. If it is done naturally, elegantly, softly, without any doubts in your mind, then you won't even come to know that the energy has risen. So Ramana Maharshi, you think he got infinite energy in him, in whichever position he's sitting, isn't it? And what is the easiest way, the best way to come back to the source? Prana bandhanat liyate mana. So what happens when you bring your attention into the sandhi of the pranas? First thing that happens is, the body separates from the body, identification drops without you knowing. Body dropping or body identification means what? What does dropping of body identification mean? Is it like I'm going to experience my body like Ramana Maharshi experienced? Oh, your body is lying down and I'm watching my body. Is it like that? Body disidentification means that on account of body, your mind is not even disturbed an iota. That is body disidentification. If you are sitting on the seat of meditation and suddenly your deep meditation and suddenly the pain, suddenly it comes and you change the position. And you feel guilty. Oh my God, my meditation is broken because of this bloody leg. I think I should cut it off. Or suddenly a scratching comes. Or suddenly a bee comes and gives you a nice sting. And it will be an automatic response. Kadak! Machhar aayega. If mosquito comes, you will give it a slap.
Or your phone rings.
Pardon me?
Or your phone rings, telephone rings.
Or your telephone rings, or your wife, or your puts a tadka in the sabji. Oh my God, why now? They don't know that I'm sitting in meditation. See? Oi. Huh? So in this way, if we are reacting to everything, but what happens to this fellow when he is sitting in meditation, that even if he slaps his mosquito, it was an auto response, and very next moment he's back to where he was. If he change, you must have also experienced this. Sometimes when you are sitting in bhajan or something, when you are deeply engrossed in a bhajan, suddenly your body changes position, but you don't give it any importance. Very next moment, even while that bhajan is going on, you are singing, you are immersed in it, and without your knowledge, the body's position is changed, and you are still immersed in the bhajan, isn't it? That time you don't complain, oh my God, bhajan is disturbed, now I can't sing because I had to change the position. Then why on the seat of meditation? Why? Because our attention, our mind is still attached to the body. When we exercise this option, and that option we have to react or not to react, and who reacts? Do you react or your mind reacts? Who reacts? The mind reacts, isn't it? The mind reacts. Now how long I'm going to keep controlling the mind from reacting? Big problem. How long am I going to keep reacting? Then what do you do? What is the solution then? It is like that small child. The child keeps demanding attention from the mother. He falls down, he wants a chocolate, he wants to get the toy. Not very young kids. And what do they do? यार ये कहाँ से निकल गया था. ये उसको दे दो. हाँ, मम्मी इज देयर, शी इज अवेयर. मम्मी इज अवेयर ऑफ द किड्स प्लेइंग. मम्मी इज अवेयर व्हेन दे आर, इफ दे मेक अ पर्टिकुलर साउंड, शी इज अवेयर दैट दिस फेलो इज हंग्री. दिस वन किड हु कम्स टू माई क्लास, शी एवरीथिंग इज गोइंग ऑन फाइन एंड सडनली शी स्टार्ट्स मूविंग लाइक दिस. यू शुड अंडरस्टैंड, शी विल नॉट रिमेंबर, गो टू द लू. If she starts moving like this, you have to tell her, go to the loo. She doesn't realize that she has to go to the loo. She start, the reaction is only movement there. So how did, mom must have come to know. So similarly, this child who is creating tantrums for attention from mom, if mom knows, how many times is she going to give attention to that child? She gets tired. But then she discovers one day that if I keep giving attention to him, this fellow keeps demanding attention. Now what she does? Let me see. If I don't give him attention, what happens? She continues doing what she's doing. He'll keep crying. She doesn't. She knows this fellow is crying. She's feeling for him or for that child also. But she is ready not to give in to his crying. And she keeps. Suddenly after some time, he stops crying and starts playing. Because he did not get the attention. But was mother not aware of that crying or that playing? She is. Exactly the same way is our mind. It is seeking attention and it gets energy, it gets momentum when you give attention to the mind. When you give attention to the mind. But the moment you become self-aware, the moment you become aware of this consciousness, the moment you become aware of this awareness, the moment you become aware of the I, whichever way you put it, the moment you become aware of this life that is throbbing through you, that very moment the mind will demand attention and you are not available. Your attention is, you are being with yourself. The mind will dance, more thoughts will come. Just like the child was, he increases his volume, but you are not available. Mind will increase its volume, you are not available. After some time, mind settles down. Just like that child settled down. And when that settling down comes, slowly, slowly, now that child, take that example only to that level, don't go further. But in our case, what happens? Here the verse was, one verse to me. In that while you were chanting, I saw this one. It's beautiful how our whoever has written it. He says, what? Thou ocean of nectar full of grace. No, not this one. Where is that river? With a very clear mind that has entered within, seeking where from this consciousness of I arises, having realized one's own nature, one becomes merged in the, he is calling that Paramatma within, that Atma within, that conscious principle within, that infinitude within as the Arunachala. He says, the more I think about you, this I-ness which is there, it gets more. Where is this I-ness? See, there are two things that happen in us. When our mind, the, I don't know, I have not taken lot of text by Ramana till now, but the thought should be the same. And that is, consciousness reflecting in the mind expresses as I thought and that thought. Aham vritti and idam vritti. And when aham vritti is, as long as aham vritti is giving attention to idam vritti, you understand idam vritti? That thought. What is that thought? Everything other than I, everything other than the consciousness is that. So when this, and what is consciousness? It is I. So when this without this I, can that appear? Cannot. So where you experience thatness, you experience it in the waking or you experience it in the dream. These are the two places. Do you experience thatness in the deep sleep? You are not available at the moment. Huh? The realized masters are available. They see that also as that. That deep sleep also as that. But we go into an ignorant bliss. That's a different story. So thatness, the variety, the differences, the sense of otherness, which the I experiences, the total experience of thatness is in the waking and the dream, isn't it? Waking in the dream. That will continue to impact the I as long as this I is attached to this three experience of waking, dream and deep sleep. Because it's with this fellow, it is becoming a waker. With this fellow, it is becoming a dreamer. And with this fellow, he is becoming a deep sleeper. Experiencing those three worlds, he is becoming, and that is the thatness. But when this, by grace of Lord, by satsang, by many people have read many, many scriptures, but grace has to come when that scripture becomes their own. Otherwise, every pujari in the temple would be realized by now. Taking so many names of the Lord for so many years. Why they don't become devotees of the Lord? Why? Because it's a mechanical repetition. It's something for in return. Puja, salary. Otherwise every Mahatma, every pujari would be a realized master. Similarly, every speaker would be realized. He is speaking only about the truth. But why it is not? Because the subjectivity is missing. That is why. See? And what is subjectivity? What is subjectivity? Is this fellow experiencing the three worlds, waking, dream and deep sleep, is this subjectivity? Or is this fellow seeking himself, recognizing himself? Subjectivity. Does he need the body, the mind, the intellect in order to know himself? No. Body, mind and intellect are because of this fellow. This is your experience. So, whom should we go give more important? To these or to this? But what do we do? We have got two questions continuously. What is that? How do we do this? Why do we do this? Isn't it? Kamiji, it's very easy. It's that simple. But then how do we do it? Example. You see with your eyes, right? You all see with your eyes. Do you know eyes are? Have you ever seen your eyes by your own eyes? But do you know the eye is? This eye, physical eye. You have never seen your own eyes with your own eyes. You may have seen other eyes. But you have never seen your own eyes. But you know they are there. Exactly the same way. EYE replace with I. Because of this I, you are having all the experiences in the mind. Do you have any doubt about that you are living or not? Do you have any doubt that you are conscious or not? Yes, you may have a doubt whether you are a waker, dreamer or deep sleeper, even in a class. But we don't have any doubt about our own consciousness. And that is what Ramana Maharshi again and again asks, prods us to contemplate on this I. Because when this I becomes aware of itself, at that very moment, the impact of the waking, dream and deep sleep, the impact of the body, mind and intellect, it stops having an impact on this I. Because now this I has got nothing to get attached to. Here in this verse, in And really speaking, what will happen? I can't remember the verses. And what happens after that? Once the I comes to abide in its own self, abide in it, comes to recognize or comes to be, then what happens? At that very moment, just like ask the sun, ask the sun, thank you for light, sun, heat and light, O sun. He says, thank you for what? Thank you for heat and light. He says, what is heat and light? I don't know. Don't give heat and light. Thank you for day and night, that we can organize our way. He says, what is day and night? I also don't know that. I don't know what is day and night, and the sun also doesn't know what is heat and light, because heat and light is his own nature. And from his point of view, who is of the nature of light, day and night is not possible. Day and night is experienced by us. The duality of day and night is experienced by us. But by the sun, it is not experienced. Because he does not know what light is, and he does not know what night is. He doesn't know, because he doesn't know what darkness means. And if you go outside this space of earth, the light which we see as brightness, it is a dark light. A total contradiction of everything. It is dark light. It becomes light only when it reflects on something. Otherwise it is dark in nature. And you ask the sun, he doesn't know anything. Exactly the same way, this I, when it becomes aware of itself, it stops seeing all the multiplicity, all the differences. They start merging into a big one homogeneous soup. There's no difference. Everything is that I alone. Yesterday one professor, he came to the satsang, and whole week I am talking only on Atma. Yesterday I said, okay, let me give my mind a break. And I talked on the Ras Leela. He says, Swamiji, it was wonderful. I said, what happened? I went to sleep. I have never had such a good sleep in my whole life. Since I became a professor. I said, why? What happened? My wife told me, Swamiji talks on Atma, consciousness, and I am doing. He is a professor in artificial intelligence. And he says, I was looking forward to question you this, and you are talking about dance, and you are talking about Krishna between two gopis, and Krishna with all the gopis. And after some time, I lost the plot, and my mind, which is so active, has never become so calm and quiet for many, many days. I really, even for 10-15 minutes that I went to sleep, it was absolutely, he just came, flew from Ireland and straight away came to satsang. I said, bahut badhiya baat hai. I said, if you can bring that about while you are awake, you are a Mahatma. Then he was awake. Now his inquiry began. He says, first I have to know. I said, why do you need to know? Are you not conscious? He says, yes. I said, well, then why do you need to know that you are conscious? Started thinking. No, but wisdom has to come about the conscious. I said, consciousness is wisdom. No, but, I said, stop. Wisdom is beyond knowing and not knowing. That was a bomb for him. For you may have all heard it, but you know when these researchers, they go so deep into it, I say anything and he knows it, because he's researching on it. He says, what did you say? Wisdom is beyond knowing and not knowing. I said, you work it out. Think what I said. And you know, like we say, we get horripilations. He was getting horripilations on his body just by that thought. He says, oh, but I have to prove that in science, scientifically he has to prove it. Consciousness cannot be proved. It is your state. And this is where we all go wrong in our life. We want to objectify this I. We are waiting for a validation. We are within ourselves in the meditation that something will happen and I will come to know that I am. You don't need to. You don't need any validation. You don't need any confirmation. You don't need any experience on the seat of meditation in order to prove that you are. But this is what we are looking for, searching for, knowingly or unknowingly, continuously. Contemplating being the self is the most direct way that Ramana Maharshi tells us, or those who are eventually, whatever path you take, when you come to this I, it is the direct way to be with yourself. At that very moment, all duality, all multiplicity, all diversity, all vanishes in toto once and for all. Once and for all. And as long as this diversity is there and slowly it is vanishing, it is like, how should I say, those are the stages that are told in certain scriptures, that now the more the mind becomes calm, the more expansive it becomes. See? The more mind becomes calm, the more expansive it becomes. The more stressed it becomes, the more grossified it becomes. And what is the grossification of stress in our mind? Disease? Worst case scenario. That is what it is. Today's scientists also speak about the same thing. That de-stress yourself, de-stress yourself, de-stress yourself. Why? That stress of the information, of the responsibilities, of the duties, of survival is expressing as the various diseases. See? And we have to get out of this. As mind, if prana bandhanat liyate manaha, as we keep exploring what is that point between the two breaths, slowly, 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 the more we offer this mind to that point, the mind starts dissolving automatically. How? Don't worry about it. Why? Don't worry about it. It will. Your mind starts dissolving every night when you go to sleep, isn't it? What effort have you put to make it to dissolve? Did you do any effort? Now I'm to give up my job. Now I'm going to give up the food. Now I'm going to give up the TV. Now I'm going to give up the body. Now I'm going to give up the clothes. Now I'm going to get into the bed. Now I'm going to give up the bed also. You don't say all those things. All you are doing after this satsang will be over, you will be thinking, when all these people will go quickly eat something, and then your attention will be only on the sleep. And when you are contemplating on the sleep, automatically the whole mind along with its diversity will drop you of its own accord. Why? Where is your focus? On the sleep. Is sleep some object to experience, to know? It is nothing. It is zero. There is no experience there. It is not an object like I can catch him and I can remember him. I can catch her in my mind as a form and I can remember her. But is sleep having a form? Then how do you remember it?
Experience memory.
Experience is what? A waker. At this moment, I am a waker and I am experiencing all of you as a object of, as a thought in my mind. In deep sleep, who is there? There is no thought. How did you experience? So where is the question of memory? There is no memory also. Then what is pulling you towards the sleep? These are worthy questions. If you want to ask this question to yourself. Don't go into a rut of thinking, I have to think of, I have to do this. What others have said, do it. Find out your way. So if there is nothing there to experience in deep sleep, who is pulling you? Why are you going there? Because there is, when you get up next morning, in deep sleep you don't know you have slept. But when you wake up in the morning, you realize it was a very blissful experience. Again the question comes, the waker was not getting an entry into the deep sleep state. So how come waker is making a statement? How come the waker is making a statement? That deep sleep was a very blissful experience. The waker cannot go into the dream or the deep sleep, and so also the other deep sleeper cannot come into the waking and the dream. There must be someone else. There must be someone else. And that is the true you. That is the real you. So when we inquire, if you want to inquire, when sometimes your mind comes into the world, don't inquire only about the waking world. Inquire about the waking, the dream and the deep sleep as one unit. Because every day you are going through these three worlds. And what happens when the eye comes and sits in eye rather than the mind? When the eye comes and sits in the mind, initially it is a thought in the mind which is thinking about the eye. But a point comes when the prana bandhanat liyate, the mind has become dissolved completely. Then the thought aspect of the eye also dissolves. You are still awake. You are not going to sleep. You are still awake. Then what happens? Then what happens is like when you are in dream, when you wake up, how much value you give to the dream? Zero. When you come to this eye and sit in this eye without thinking, then to this waking world you give zero value. That very moment, only once it needs to happen, that very moment, a Mahatma is, people call him a Mahatma. For him it is very normal. For you also it is very normal. Hey, what is so big deal about the dream? It is just a figment of imagination. So also this whole waking world is also a figment of imagination in your mind. Where has this, in dream you see space, air, fire, water, earth, people, trees, rivers, mountains. Where have they come from? Have they come from outside? Your mind itself became everything. Your eye consciousness, the dreamer consciousness, if you come out now, you know, when you're thinking about dream, that consciousness alone became the dreamer, and that consciousness alone borrowed itself to all the characters and animals and the germs and the amoebas in the dream. That same consciousness became many, as if. And when you wake up, zero value. Exactly the same thing is happening in the waking world also. The entire world, relationships, people, space, air, fire, water, everything is nothing but the mind alone. But you need to wake up from this. And the only way to wake up is not by control of mind. It is by being the consciousness. Coming back to the source. And we are saying the source only because our attention is on something else. So we are saying the source. But once you come to the source, you realize that there is nothing but me. There is nothing else apart from this self, apart from this consciousness. So at that moment, the individual I, the seeker I, the ego I vanishes. When will it vanish? When the thought aspect of the I dies, that very moment the ego dies. When the thought aspect of the ego dies, then I still remains, but without a thought. And that is your true nature. That is the absolute I. Bolo Sadguru Nath Maharaj ki jai.
Purnamasam.
Om.